Good morning. I'm Jim Gerritsen. My family and I have a MOFCA certified organic farm up in Aroosa County. And my job is to introduce this morning's keynote speaker, my friend Stephen Druker. Before I get to that, I want to take this opportunity to give you a little update on the Maine GMO labeling law that we passed in Maine 2 years ago, and which now is under threat by preemption by the federal Congress in Washington, D.C. So, what I've got here are some large postcards that MOFCA has printed out, and what it does is provides information about the DARC Act, which is what we're calling this bill by Congressman Pompeo of Missouri, or Kansas. And it would, if passed, it passed the House in July, and it's now on its way to the Senate. If it would pass, it would preempt Maine's GMO label law and any other labeling law in the United States by preventing, at the federal level, individual states from having GMO labeling. It would also prevent local control of genetically engineered crops, such as have passed along the West Coast, Jackson County, Oregon, Josephine County, Oregon, down to California and up to San Juan Island, Washington. So we think that these are ideas that should be state controlled. When Maine passed the GMO label law 2 years ago, we had nearly unanimous support in the Maine legislature. The bill passed 141-4 in the House and 35-0 in the Senate, and Governor LePage signed the bill into law. What this indicates is that, and in addition, there was a poll done of Mainers, and 90% of Mainers supported GMO labeling. The essence is that Maine wants to know about GMO food, and it's not the place of the federal government to preempt our right to know. You to do with these postcards, please take two of them, bring them home, and it's asking you to call both of our U.S. Senators, Senator Susan Collins and Senator Angus King, and urge their opposition to the DARC Act, and in addition, urge that they become champions against the DARC Act. And they will listen to what we have to say, because this is very important to Maine. And when this bill came up for a vote in the House, both of our Congress, members of Congress, Shelley Pingree and Bruce Poliquin, both of them voted in opposition of the DARC Act in support of Maine's rights. So we need our senators to do this too. Okay, enough about that. On a related topic, it's very rare that we have a hero of the stature of Steve Druker to come here to Maine and to speak at the Common Ground Fair. Steve is the executive director of the Alliance for Biointegrity, and it was that group which filed a landmark federal lawsuit which forced the FDA to open up their records. And through the discovery process, Steve came up with smoking gun evidence that the FDA's own scientists have serious concerns about the health safety of GE crops. And it was only through his persistence and his lifelong commitment to this challenge that now the truth is finally coming out. This book, Altered Genes, Twisted Truth, was written by Steve Druker, and it came out this spring. It represents a lifetime's work of bringing out the truth of genetically engineered crops. This book is for sale here at the fair at the Gulf of Maine bookstore in the white tent right behind the MOFCA booth. So I would encourage you to buy the book, and tomorrow, if you're going to be at the fair tomorrow, Steve is going to have a book signing. So whether you buy the book today or buy the book tomorrow, bring your book by. And I've got my book, and I'm going to have Steve sign it for me. But show your support. The last I talked to Steve a few weeks ago at the National Heirloom Expo in Santa Rosa, California, 18,000 copies of this book have already been sold. And that's in the context of an entire news blackout by the mainstream media that for some reason doesn't want to cover something that is of primal importance to all of us and all of our families, and that's the safety of GE food. So without further ado, from the cornfields of Iowa, please welcome Steve Druker.
Thank you. It's a great honor and a great pleasure to be a keynote speaker at this terrific fair. What a great day and a great crowd, and it's also an honor to have Jim Gerritsen introduce me and to have introduced me with probably more praise than I deserve, but I deeply appreciate it. Let's just consider something. What do you think would happen if, through a sudden, miraculous flash of illumination, everybody in the world suddenly gained full awareness of all the facts about genetically engineered foods, and everybody's opinion about these foods became firmly grounded in solid science? Well, if we listen to the routine rhetoric of the proponents of genetically engineered foods, then we would have to predict that such a universal flash of enlightenment would completely end all opposition to them. Because they're... You can't hear? Oh, sorry. Sony, I think they were just waving to friends. I thought they were saying to speak up. Because they're always telling us that all the opposition to GMOs is based in ignorance and based in people who just don't get the science. And if everybody's opinion were just based on solid science, there wouldn't be all of this opposition, and genetically engineered foods would be available everywhere, not just in the United States and Canada and a few other countries whose governments have been weak enough to let them on the market. But of course, in the world we actually inhabit, in this concrete world in which you and I live, we know that that wouldn't happen. In fact, if there was universal enlightenment about the facts of genetically engineered food, if everybody actually knew the facts, what would quickly collapse, what would quickly vanish, would not be the opposition to the foods, but the foods themselves. Yeah. And that's because, for one thing, research in several countries has consistently shown over a number of years that there's a direct correlation between the public's knowledge of genetically engineered foods and its willingness to accept them. And that the more people know about these foods, the more they do learn the facts, the greater their resistance to them, the greater their concerns about them. And of course, that is why, despite all of their repeated pretensions to the contrary, the proponents of genetically engineered foods have gone out of their way to suppress the facts and to distort the evidence. Whatever they can't suppress, then they distort. And that has been a constant phenomenon. In fact, my book documents solidly case after case in which the proponents of genetically engineered foods, not just Monsanto, not just DuPont, but primarily actually, and most worryingly, eminent scientists and scientific institutions have strained to keep evidence from the public and to suppress whatever evidence might start getting talked about in public. if their research, scientific research that goes against genetically engineered foods, they will attack it viciously. Whatever, if there's a book that comes out like mine, they'll attack it viciously, unfairly, usually without even having read it. Because the main thing is, they are threatened by the evidence. Because full knowledge, the fuller the awareness of the facts, the more danger there is to this great project, massive project, to reconfigure the genetic core of the world's food supply. In fact, as my book documents, the extent of the deception itself, the extent to which the proponents of genetically engineered foods have had to twist the truth, is itself one of the strongest pieces of evidence as to how strongly the evidence weighs against the safety of these foods. Because just think about it. If the evidence in favor of the safety of genetically engineered foods were actually as strong as its proponents purport it to be, there wouldn't have been any need to distort it. If you've got the evidence on your side, if the facts favor you, you don't distort it, you just present the facts simply and positively. It's right there. You only resort to deception, to trickery, when the evidence goes against you and you have to fight like a cornered rat. And there have been far too many cornered rats fighting in this affair. So what I'd like to do with you in the next few minutes is examine the key claims about the safety and acceptability of genetically engineered foods that are dispensed by their promoters and compare them to the actual facts. And this is an exercise that will make it quite clear why widespread knowledge of these facts would doom the colossal venture that's producing and promoting these foods. Okay, what's one of the main claims? We've heard it repeatedly ad nauseum, that genetic engineering is just a simple extension of traditional breeding, that it's really nothing new, that, gee, after all, farmers since time immemorial have been altering the genetics of foods. And it even picked up with the likes of George Washington Carver and Luther Burbank. We're not doing anything really different from what they did. And to the extent that genetic engineering is different than traditional breeding, it's supposed to be more precise and even safer. That's baloney. That's total baloney. Okay, now, one of the claims that's in this line is there's a seamless continuum. That there's a seamless continuum between just simple selection of the seeds that are seen to be seeds from the varieties that work the best, and replanting. There's a seamless continuum from that ancient practice through every other phase of conventional breeding right up to genetic engineering. There's one seamless continuum, and of course that's also baloney. For instance, a Nobel laureate biologist who spent most of his career as a professor at Harvard, George Wald, stated when discussing genetically engineered foods, or genetic engineering itself, it is the biggest break in nature that's occurred in human history. And then Professor Wald continued, such intervention must not be confused with previous intrusions upon the natural order of living organisms. Another eminent biologist who has also pointed out the falsity of that claim is Dr. Lieb Cavalieri, who, when the American Association for the Advancement of Science gave its first forum on genetically engineered crops, they selected Dr. Cavalieri to represent the viewpoint of science. And what Dr. Cavalieri has been saying there and has said since is that those scientists that claim that genetic engineering is just a simple extension of traditional breeding, essentially the same thing, he said they're perpetrating a sham. He used that word. He said it's a sham. He said it's disgraceful. He said they should be ashamed of themselves. What about the claim that it's more precise? It's random. The genetically engineered foods that are on our markets today are not the result of a precise process of gene transfer and implantation. The technologists who created these crops had no control, essentially, almost no control over where those genetic implants went. And when they claim it's more precise, it's just not true at all. Now, another claim is that no product of genetic engineering has ever harmed a human being. Okay? And in fact, a few years ago, an official with the United States government claimed that no product of genetic engineering had caused so much as a sneeze or a sniffle. Well, that's really interesting, especially in light of the fact that in 1989 and 1990, the very first ingestible product of genetic engineering that came to market caused a major epidemic in the United States. Dozens of Americans were killed. Thousands were seriously sickened, according to the most recent estimate from the Center for Disease Control. Between 4,000 and 5,000 Americans were seriously sickened by that product of genetic engineering. And hundreds of those who were sickened remain invalids to this very day. Okay? That was clearly caused by a product of genetic engineering. In this case, it was a food supplement of the essential amino acid L-tryptophan, and it had been produced by bacteria that had been genetically engineered. Now, a little background. As I said, L-tryptophan is an essential amino acid. We all need it. It's just one of the eight that we can't synthesize ourselves, so we need to get it from food or from supplements. Most people get as much as they need from food, but people who are having trouble sleeping or who need more relaxation were taking supplements, and it was a very healthful and cheap and natural alternative to many of the sedatives that were on the market, the prescription drugs. And for years and years, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people around the world have been safely consuming L-tryptophan supplements, and they've been produced by bacteria that naturally produce it. So the bacteria were utilized by manufacturers to synthesize the L-tryptophan that they do anyway, and then it was separated from the bacteria and purified and put into supplements. But the one supplement that caused this toxic contamination went through a unique process. Its manufacturer decided to try to make more money by engineering the bacteria to crank out more L-tryptophan in the same period of time, and therefore make more money. And that manufacturer used genetic engineering, and it's very important, the bacteria were given extra copies of some of their own genes. Okay? They were not given foreign, they were not expressing foreign genes. They were just forced to produce more of what they ordinarily produce. And that forced overproduction of some substance is what happens in just about every instance of a genetically engineered food product. So that's why what happened with this very first one is relevant to everything that came after. And it didn't even involve, as I said, a foreign gene. But that forced overproduction of an amino acid that is needed by the bacteria, that we know that that's actually at high levels toxic to the bacteria. The bacteria have very refined mechanisms to make sure that the production of L-tryptophan stays within certain levels. And those biological controls were forcefully overridden by the genetic engineering. And something appears to have gone wrong. We don't have conclusive proof that the unusual toxic contamination that caused that epidemic was caused by the genetic engineering, but the evidence as a whole strongly points toward it. Strongly points toward it. I won't go into all the details. There's an entire chapter in my book on that incident. But it's very important to understand that that supplement was pure according to pharmacological standards. It tested pure at the 99% plus percentile. Now, every supplement, almost all supplements like that, have a little bit of contamination in them. It's hard to get rid of it all. But if it's below a certain level, it's presumed safe. Okay? But somehow, one or another toxicant within that product was so lethal at an extremely low level, a level so low that in almost any other instance it wouldn't have caused any sneeze or sniffle, no problem at all, caused major, many deaths and thousands of serious infirmities. So that's the kind of thing that can happen because bacteria and plants produce chemicals to fend off predators, okay? Think about it. We can move, animals can move around and have many other defense mechanisms, but bacteria and plants, really, their defenses are, bacteria can move a little, but they're only cells, so they don't really have limbs, they don't have, the best way for them to compete with other microorganisms is to produce chemicals that can fend off other organisms. And plants are the same, in the same situation. They can't move at all. They're rooted, okay? So plants are very adroit at manufacturing a whole range of chemicals that can protect them, some of which can be toxic. And there can be novel chemicals that are produced if the metabolism of the plant or the bacteria is disrupted. And genetic engineering disrupts that metabolic process. It's well known. It creates many kinds of disruptions. And it appears to, in the case of these bacteria that were produced in the L-tryptophan, to have created just such a disruption. Some, and there are many indications that disruption was created. I'm emphasizing this, A, because it's so important to know that a product of genetic engineering, the very first one, in fact, did create major health problems. And if the evidence, if the facts about that epidemic had been fairly reported, it probably would have stopped things right there. It certainly would have slowed up the whole rush to get genetically engineered products on the market. But what happened was the FDA, our own Food and Drug Administration, went out of its way to suppress evidence, to distort whatever evidence leaked out, and the scientific establishment helped. And that's why most people don't even realize today that there was an epidemic that was linked with a product of genetic engineering. I've talked to many public health professionals, and most of them don't even know that such an epidemic occurred and that it was linked to a product of genetic engineering. That's how well the facts have been suppressed. That's how thoroughly people have been hoodwinked. By the way, the very first food produced by genetic engineering, whole food produced by genetic engineering, also caused problems. It was a tomato, the Flavor Saver tomato. And the manufacturer of that tomato did some tests, safety testing, employing the whole food. The FDA scientists were asked to review those studies, and the FDA experts, in particular the pathology branch, the experts at reviewing research and trying to determine whether results on animals are problematic, they noted a problematic pattern of lesions in the rats that have been consuming the genetically engineered tomato in comparison with the control group that had been lucky enough to be spared that diet and were eating regular tomatoes. And they said, their memos state that the data raised a safety issue that could not be resolved unless further testing was done. They said, we need more testing in order to resolve this safety issue that's been raised by the research. What did the administrators of the Food and Drug Administration do faced with that kind of input? They didn't require any new tests. In fact, they didn't tell the they didn't even suggest to the manufacturer that it do new tests. Now, initially, they had suggested that the manufacturer did do some tests a few years before that, but when the evidence came in a way they didn't want, that was the end of it. They wanted to pretend that the tests didn't occur. And in fact, in their official statements about the tomato, you wouldn't even get the understanding that safety testing of the whole food was done. They list all of the different pieces of data they reviewed. That isn't one of them, because they decided to cover that one up. And they announced in public that their scientists had reviewed all of the data on the tomatoes and that all safety questions had been resolved and that their scientists had concluded that that tomato was as safe as any other tomato. That's an outright lie. But the FDA did it so that the very first whole food produced by genetic engineering could make it onto the market too. So they covered up and twisted the evidence about the epidemic that was caused by the very first ingestible product of genetic engineering, and then a few years later they had to suppress evidence and distort evidence and lie once again in order to enable the very first whole food produced by genetic engineering to reach the market. If you're beginning to see an uncomfortable pattern here, it gets worse. Time and again, the FDA has gone out of its way to basically deceive the public so that genetic engineering could continue. And that leads to one of the other claims about genetic engineered food, that our Food and Drug Administration is regulating these foods very carefully, that they have to go through very rigorous scientific review, and we should all be very confident that our FDA is on the job. Boy, that's one of the biggest fairy tales out there at all. In reality, our Food and Drug Administration is not regulating genetically engineered foods one iota, and they've admitted that when push came to shove in court. They are not regulating genetically engineered foods one smidgen. In fact, not only do the manufacturers, according to the FDA, not have to send the FDA any test data or do any tests, according to the FDA, no manufacturer even has to give the FDA notice that it's going to dump a genetically engineered food on our market. And that could have been happening right now. The FDA has no credible knowledge about every genetically engineered food, the potential presence of every genetically engineered food on our market. Somebody in our country or in a foreign country, a manufacturer, could have had extensive trials going on a crop that didn't go well. What do we do with the crop? Send it to the U.S. We don't have to give any notice. Now, by law, really, there should be not only notice but testing. But according to the FDA, zero requirements. Now, there's some consultation process that the FDA engages in with most of the manufacturers that's totally voluntary. And it is set up to allow the pretense, the illusion that there's some scientific testing going on, but without any scientific review at all. And in fact, the FDA has admitted in a few documents, and I report this in the book, it's clearly on the record that the FDA has conceded that voluntary consultation process is not a bona fide scientific review process. In fact, they don't even see original test data to the extent there is any data. You can't have a scientific review if you're not looking at the test data. But the FDA does not want to be bothered with that, because then they might find something troubling again, as in the case of the L-tryptophan supplement or the case of the flavor saver tomato. So the less the FDA learns, the better they want. They like it, because then they don't have to lie as much. There's less evidence to cover up. Just so you'll know, our federal food safety laws in this country in regards to genetically engineered foods are the strictest in the world. Now, most people don't realize that. They think that the European Union has stronger food safety laws for good reason. because you can go into even a fast food convenience store in almost any EU nation, and you'll be hard-pressed to find a single product on its shelves that contains a GMO. When you go into the average health food store in the United States, you look at the packaged products, you will still find many of them that contain genetic ingredients from genetically engineered foods. You can find that in health food stores here. So it's very reasonable to conclude that the difference is that the laws in the EU are stronger and the laws here are weaker. No, our laws are stronger. The difference is our laws aren't being enforced. The FDA has willfully violated the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act when it comes to new food additives. And that law that was the additive, the essential amendment to the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act that is relevant, was passed by Congress in 1958, signed into law by President Eisenhower. And an official Senate report states very clearly that while Congress, this is a report on the intent of Congress in passing that law, while Congress did not want to unnecessarily impede progress, nevertheless, it is the intent of Congress that new additives to food be proven safe before they're allowed on the market. And the FDA has admitted that the genetic constructs that are added to these genetically engineered foods do count and do fall under the purview of that law. They are new additions to the food. And they're according to law, they're supposed to be presumed unsafe, and they have to be proven safe through standard scientific procedures. But the FDA has violated that law. They've lied to the public. They've claimed that there's an overwhelming consensus within the scientific community that these foods are as safe as other foods and that they don't need to be tested. But guess what? As Jim mentioned in his introduction, the lawsuit that I organized against the FDA forced the FDA to divulge over 44,000 pages of its internal files. And I found memo after memo from the FDA's own scientists who were charged by the FDA administrators to actually review the issue of genetic engineering. They, in memo after memo from the various branches, microbiology and toxicology and Center for Veterinary Medicine, cautionary statements stating that genetic engineering is different than conventional breeding, that it entails a unique set of risks, and that the foods it produces should not be presumed safe unless and until each one of them is demonstrated safe through solid testing. So what the FDA scientists were telling the FDA administrators was, from the standpoint of science, these foods should also be presumed unsafe until demonstrated safe, because that's what our law also requires, that they're presumed unsafe until demonstrated safe. So from the standpoint both of the law and of sound science, as it was interpreted by the FDA's own scientists, none of these foods should be on the market right now, because none of them has been demonstrated safe according to the level of testing that is required by our law. That's why the FDA had to also cover up all of those warnings of its scientists. And it just didn't cover it up. It lied about them. In its official policy statement on genetically engineered foods issued in May of 1992, the FDA claimed that the agency is not aware of any information showing that foods produced by these new methods differ in any uniform or meaningful way from other food. Okay, you got that? We're not aware of any information. Wow. I guess they don't consider memoranda from their own scientific experts who they asked to review the issue as information. I guess all that counts as information in the eyes of the FDA is the disinformation that they and the biotech promoters have so lavishly dispensed ever since May of 1992. So we're living in a very Orwellian world, a kind of a world of that novel 1984, where information from the FDA scientists doesn't count as information, and what does count as information is the disinformation. So it's a very strange situation, very deplorable, but unfortunately that's been the situation for these last, you know, many, many years, since 1992. What about the claim that there's a scientific consensus, an overwhelming scientific consensus that these foods are safe? Well, of course, we see that the overwhelming consensus within the FDA's own scientific branch was the opposite. And in fact, so pervasive were the concerns within the FDA's scientific branch that an FDA compliance officer, whose job it was to review the data from the scientists, wrote a scathing memo to the FDA's biotechnology coordinator complaining that the FDA policy, as she could see it being developed, was trying to fit a square peg in a round hole by trying to force an ultimate conclusion that the products produced by genetic engineering are essentially the same as the products of conventional breeding. And then she stated, the processes of genetic engineering and traditional breeding are different, and according to the technical experts in the agency, they lead to different risks. And one of the documents in the FDA files that I think is most damning is a letter from the FDA's own biotechnology coordinator to a Canadian health official admitting that there was not a consensus about safety within the scientific community at large either. So the FDA knew that the overwhelming consensus among its own scientists was that genetic engineering is different and cannot be presumed safe, and that these products have to be tested. It also knew there was not a consensus about safety within the scientific community. And yet it claimed in public that there is. And in fact, as I speak, the sole purported legal basis from the side of the FDA's sole purported legal basis for the marketing of these foods in the U.S., the reason it claims they can be on our supermarket shelves is that there's an overwhelming consensus in the scientific community that they're safe, and that consensus is backed up by solid technical evidence. That's just baloney. There's no consensus, and the technical evidence is lacking too. It was lacking in May of 1992. It's still lacking today. And there have been several scientific institutions that have issued warnings about genetically engineered foods. And just recently, last January, over 300 scientists signed a statement stating that there's no consensus about the safety of genetically engineered foods in the scientific community. And that's been published in a peer-reviewed journal. And yet the FDA continues to claim that there is a consensus. And that claim of consensus, that false claim, remains the sole purported legal basis for the marketing of these foods in the United States today. That's how bad it is. Well, there is a lack of technical evidence, okay? Now there's one of the claims we will also hear is these foods have been solidly tested and the evidence has demonstrated they're safe. No, that's not true at all. Several well-conducted studies have been published in peer-reviewed journals that have shown statistically significant harm to the laboratory animals that were unfortunate enough to have dined upon genetically engineered foods. They've been unjustly attacked, those studies, but those studies stand. And they alone are sufficient to cast doubt on the safety of the other genetically engineered foods. Even really the epidemic caused by that supplement was enough to have stopped it, slowed it up. Because as I said, what happened there has implications for all genetically engineered foods. It's also interesting that when independent scientists have reviewed some of the research that has been done and submitted to regulators around the world that has been approved by the regulators for foods that are on the market, they find that right within that data there are problems that the regulators didn't catch, because the regulators, most regulatory bodies, also like the FDA, have a promotional policy. They are trying to promote biotechnology, the biotechnology industry in their countries, while they also purport to be able to regulate its products responsibly. You can't do both. That's a huge conflict of interest. The history of the FDA, the history of the European Food Safety Agency, they attest to it. The history of what's been going on in Australia, attest to the fact that when regulators have a have an agenda to promote, they cannot also responsibly regulate. And one of the most troubling studies was when independent scientists reviewed a number of the products, genetically engineered products, that are actually on the market. You've probably been eating them. Your kids have probably been eating them when they go to birthday parties or wherever, if you can't control what they're eating. They found that actually several of the measured indices actually did show problems. And the most troublesome indications were to the livers and the kidneys. And the scientists state that that's especially worrisome because the livers and the kidneys are the main reactive organs in the case of chronic toxicity. So this is a red flag, a warning flag, that the animals that were on these tests, and these were not long-term tests, by the way. They were short-term or medium-term. That just the short-term or medium-term consumption of the GMOs was creating statistically significant disruption to livers and kidneys. That is not a good sign. That needs to be followed up on, but it hasn't been adequately followed up on. So, just this review of some of the main claims and the extent to which they are at odds with the actual evidence, I think gives a flavor again, not more of a flavor, does substantiate the claim with which I began. But this massive venture to reconfigure the genetic core of the world's food supply rests on a foundation of falsehood and fraud. And it is extremely vulnerable to the facts. And that is why its proponents have so strenuously striven to distort the facts. Because once the evidence gets out there, and it is bound to at some point, if enough people read my book, or if just a few key people read the book, the whole thing will be over. It will plummet because this massive venture has an Achilles heel that runs all the way up to its buttocks. It is so vulnerable. All we need to do is disseminate the facts. And when we do, and you, obviously these labeling campaigns have been so important in educating the public, but there's a deeper right that's been violated. Not just our right to know whether foods have been genetically engineered, but there's a statutorily granted right in our country not to have been exposed to untested genetically engineered foods in the first place. And that's a right that's been violated year after year. So the remedy that we really need to put into effect, and that I think can happen very soon when the evidence gets out in a broad enough manner, is not merely to label these foods, but to take them off the market. These foods should have never come to market in the first place. They only came to market through fraud, and they will, when the facts are more fully understood, they will be removed from the market very quickly. And agriculture can then focus upon safe, sustainable forms of agriculture that the sponsor of this wonderful event is promoting. Okay? Safe, sustainable agroecological techniques that produce safe foods that are good for the environment and good for the humans and the farm animals that eat the foods. Thank you very much. Do a brief question and answer session, and Jim will be helping moderate that.
If anyone came in late, I want to make sure that you get one of these postcards. Mofka helped pass a GMO labeling bill in the state of Maine 2 years ago. I was part of the team that helped pass that. And now federal legislation is threatening to preempt and nullify Maine's GMO label law. The action is turning to the U.S. Senate, and it's imperative that every one of us call Senator Angus King and Senator Susan Collins and urge them to oppose the DARC Act. All the information you need is on this card. There are two telephone numbers on here for calling each of the senators' offices. Go ahead and program these numbers into your cell phones and make the call next week. We need at least a dozen calls every day from here until the death of the Dark Act. Steve made reference in his talk about his book. It's called Altered Genes, Twisted Truth, and you can buy your own copy at the Gulf of Maine Books booth, which is the white tent right behind the moth booth. So he'll have a book signing tomorrow. If you buy the book today, come tomorrow and he'll be happy to sign it. So we have a few minutes left. We'll entertain any questions. Please keep them short, and I'll repeat the question.
Okay, what is the position of our senators right now on the DOC Act?
Okay. The question is, what is the position right now of our two main U.S. senators on the DARK Act? Steve defers to me. My understanding is that neither one of them has made a public statement on their position, but keep in mind that both of our members of Congress in July, when this came up to the House, it passed the House, but both Shelley Pingree and Bruce Poliquin voted to oppose the DARK Act. They voted the right way. Yes.
Has anybody put the FDA memos that you referred to up on the web so we can all look at them?
The question is, has anyone put the FDA memos up on the web?
Yes, I should have mentioned that. Actually, I did. Back in, I think, late 1999 or 2000. They've been up since then. They're public record, 24 of the key documents at the website of the Alliance for Biointegrity, www.biointegrity.org, biointegrity.org. And by the way, I wanted them up there because I figured, hey, it'll be all over. The media will report it. The mainstream American media, even when investigative reporters have wanted to break the story on that, their editors or somebody higher up in the chain has shut it down. The mainstream American media has suppressed the evidence, has tried to, again, keep the American people hoodwinked about this, because they also, unfortunately, are, for the most part, the mainstream media promoting genetically engineered foods, trying to protect the image of these foods, trying to keep Americans from learning the truth.
Yeah. Is there any prospect of a lawsuit to force the FDA to follow the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act?
Is there any, the question is there any prospect of a lawsuit to force the USA, the FDA, to act honestly?
Well, that's what the lawsuit I organized was aimed to do, and there were some, it's a little complex to go into it now. We got the evidence. The judge acknowledged we had shown that as of the time we filed the lawsuit, that there was a significant dispute among scientific experts about the safety of these foods, which essentially meant they were not generally recognized as safe as of May of 1998. But then she said, but the important thing is, just for purposes of this suit, were the FDA administrators acting arbitrarily and capriciously in May of 1998, when they presumed that they could be, they presumed that they were generally recognized as safe? And she said, through many adroit moves, I'm going to give them, they had discretion to do that. She ignored a lot of data to do that, but she actually acknowledged, what people don't realize is, she acknowledged we had shown these foods were not generally recognized as safe as of May of 1998. And people just don't even get that. So it'd be difficult for me to bring another lawsuit. Somebody else could, but my feeling is lawsuits take time. It'd be much quicker just to get the evidence out there, finally break through, show how the FDA has been breaking the law and lying, and I think that would be more effective and quicker. But if any lawyers want to do another suit, more power to you, you know. Do whatever works. Whatever you think will work, do it. Yes?
Yes.
The evidence that Don Huber has reported about the rising incidence of soil diseases like Fusarium from Roundup and the rising incidence of celiac disease, what will it take to get that evidence to bring it to the fore?
Okay, the question is, Dr. Donald Huber, a retired Purdue scientist, has provided evidence of increased amount of fusarium in the soil and other soil degradation, and maybe Steve can comment.
Well, Dr. Huber is an expert on that, and even though the other side has been viciously and unjustly attacking him, I certainly support his work. I know he's a man of great integrity, and I had the pleasure of finally meeting him in person at a conference in California a few weeks ago. He came up to me and praised me for the book, by the way. He told me how much he liked it. And so anyway, Don Huber is a great champion and a great man, and his research should be taken seriously.
Do you discuss the link to celiac in the book?
I didn't hear that, I'm sorry.
The question is the link to celiac with Dr. Huber. The link to celiac disease, you have?
I'm really not confident to go into that in any greater detail than he did. So, are you saying linked to celiac disease?
Yes.
I know there are several, in addition to Dr. Huber, several scientists, and I think that specifically relates to the glyphosate issue, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So, the herbicide glyphosate that's been sprayed on so many of the genetically engineered crops that were engineered to resist it, several scientists have been accumulating data that they feel does point to that as a possibility that the glyphosate could be linked to celiac disease. I'm not going to comment on that other than to say that I would just refer you to what they're saying. They have good credentials. There's some very good arguments could be made to that effect. I don't talk about the glyphosate as much because A, many other people are doing it, and B, not every genetically engineered crop is sprayed with glyphosate, and in fact, many of the new ones in the pipeline won't be. I'm focusing on the general risks of genetic engineering process itself. Glyphosate adds a new level of risk, but the fact that any crop was produced through recombinant DNA technology is in itself a risky factor. Okay? There's risk entailed any time the technology is used, whether or not any herbicides are sprayed upon it. Even if it's grown organically, there would be a higher level of risk. And that's what is too often overlooked. And so my focus is on the general background risks of genetic engineering itself. All of these other points are also very important, and they should be made and paid attention to.
Do you get into gene editing?
I've been reminded, we're down to the last minute or two here, but I've been reminded that there are 49 other states beyond Maine. It's hard to remember that sometimes. But those states do have two senators, so if you are not from the state of Maine, when you go back home, take one of these yellow postcards. The information is good, and all you need to get is the telephone numbers for each of your two U.S. senators. And you can Google that by going U.S. Senate and your state, Massachusetts, and telephone number, and you'll get the number that you need to call. But everybody everywhere needs to call. You had a question here.
Yeah. I was wondering if you would please comment on the FDA increasing the allowable limit of glyphosate.
Another question about glyphosate and the U.S. FDA increasing the allowable level of glyphosate in food for human consumption.
Do you know those levels?
Actually, I believe it was the EPA that allowed the increase because they're involved with pesticides and herbicides. My understanding is that every increase in the allowable level of that chemical herbicide or other herbicides that are needed for herbicide-resistant GMOs have been done on the basis of very insufficient evidence, and that there's really no solid scientific backing for that increase. That's my understanding, and so again, it's just our government has been promoting genetically engineered foods really very strongly ever since 1986 under Ronald Reagan's White House, when there was a directive that went out to all of the federal administrative agencies to promote the biotech industry as much as possible, to ease the introduction of its products onto domestic and foreign markets. And so we continually see this bending over backwards on the part of the EPA and the USDA and the FDA to promote biotechnology and to basically give as free a ride as possible to its products. And the law has certainly been broken on the side of the FDA, and I'm pretty sure if people looked into it thoroughly, they'd see that many laws or at least policies have been twisted or bent on the part of other agencies as well.
We've got time for one more question. Yeah, you have one. The question is, we've been talking about the FDA, but what is the role of the U.S. Department of Agriculture?
Again, their role is, they see themselves as promoting. The promotional directive went out under Reagan. It's been renewed under every successive White House, so the Bill Clinton White House and unfortunately the Barack Obama White House have been promoting genetically engineered foods just as strongly as have their Republican predecessors. So the USDA has also been doing basically promotional work. Dan Glickman, who was the Secretary of Agriculture under Clinton, has admitted that he basically, all the promotional cheerleading statements were just written into his speeches. He said, I just stated what was in my speeches, and he was making claims that all these foods have been rigorously tested and proven safe. That's not true at all, but they were written into his speeches. So he's admitted after he left his office that a lot of this promotional stuff is just there. It was a policy, he had to do it. That was his job, to promote. I just want to mention, I noticed standing over there, a gentleman, Lonnie Gamble. He's wearing he's got a goatee. Just wave, hold up your hand. Lonnie is the co-director of one of the premier sustainable living programs at a university in the United States. So if anybody's interested in talking with him and getting more information, he'll be happy to talk with you.
Ask one final question for Steve to answer, and that's, what can we as individuals do right now to stop GMO crops?
Well, there are many things you could do. Certainly what Jim has been urging you to do is important in terms of that DARC Act, by the way, would not just stop states from being able to require labeling of GMOs within their borders. It would actually amend the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act and make legal what is now illegal. The FDA's now illegal actions in just allowing these foods to come to market through voluntary consultation process, that will now have the force of law, that all they have to do is just go through the voluntary process the way it is right now. So people don't realize that. That's one of the sneaky parts of the law. It will change amend the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act and give genetically engineered foods a special exemption, which they now do not enjoy legally, but the FDA is giving them. That will now legalize that illegal exemption. So that's another reason it's a very, very tricky act. I would say get the facts, get concerned, but you know, it's always act locally. First, make sure that you're not buying these foods. You're voting with your pocketbook anytime you buy a food containing genetically engineered foods. And if you see, especially at a health food store, if you see a package that you can see it contains soy or corn in it, and that particular ingredient isn't certified organic, you can be almost sure that that's from a genetically engineered variety. I think you should take that package to the store manager and say, why are you selling foods containing GMOs? You know, that's why Europe, by the way, doesn't have these foods. It wasn't the European governments, it was the European consumers who were alerted by the European media, which actually did report on on problematic scientific studies, but it was the European consumers who rose up and made it so clear that they weren't going to buy them. It was the major food distributors that said, we're not going to carry it. And that's what stopped it in Europe. It wasn't the governments. It was the consumers. And American consumers have been too asleep on this issue. Now, I know the media's been going out of their way to keep consumers asleep and uninformed, but once you know the facts, then get active. You have to actually shop intelligently, avoid eating GMOs, stop feeding them to your kids, and stop voting for them with your pocketbook. And if enough people stop buying them, that's going to send a very strong message to industry. So I would say shop intelligently, and then also make ripples. Start talking about it to your friends, and ripples combine with other ripples and make a big wave. So do whatever you think is effective, but just do it.
On behalf of MAFCA, I'd like to present Steve with a MAFCA t-shirt. Okay, I guess this concludes the presentation. Thank you.